إن الحمد لله نحمده تعالى ونشكره ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله خير من دعا إلى الله، أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح للأمة وتركها على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله. أما بعد، فيا عباد الله، إن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد بن عبد الله، وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة في الدين بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. يقول ربنا تبارك وتعالى في سورة الكهف حاكيا لنا قصة أصحاب الكهف، فيقول: إنهم فتية آمنوا بربهم وزدناهم هدى وربطنا على قلوبهم إذ قاموا فقالوا ربنا رب السماوات والأرض لن ندعو من دونه إلها لقد قلنا إذا شططا. يا عباد الله، هؤلاء فتية، والفتية هم صغار السن من الشباب. قص الله سبحانه وتعالى علينا في سورة الكهف قصتهم، وبين لنا كيف أن هؤلاء الفتية كانوا أمة وحدهم في مواجهة أمتهم وقومهم ممن كانوا على الكفر والشرك. هؤلاء الكل الذين ذكر الله سبحانه وتعالى عددهم فيما بين الثلاثة إلى الستة أو السبعة في مقابل ألوف الناس، كيف أن الله سبحانه وتعالى أيدهم على كلتهم وعلى حداثة أسنانهم، وكيف نصرهم الله سبحانه وتعالى وأعلى دينهم وجعل كلمته هي العليا، فأصبح دينهم هو الدين الظاهر في الأرض. الشاهد إخوة الإسلام أن المسارعين إلى الحق دائما والذين بهم ينصر الدين إنما هم فئة الشباب، فقد كان أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم الأوائل ممن صدقوا به وآمنوا به، كان جلهم غالبيتهم من الشباب، وكان أكبرهم وشيخهم أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه وأرضاه، كان عمره 42 عاما، لأنه نفسه كان شابا، ولكن لحداثة أسنان الآخرين كونهم أقل منه بكثير كان يعتبر شيخا بالنسبة لهم، فيسمونه شيخ الصحابة. أما عمر فكان 26، وحمزة كان 28، والباقي كثير منهم كان دون 20 من عمره حينما آمنوا وحينما نصروا النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. لذلك كان الشباب في كل أمة من الأمم هم العنصر الرئيسي فيها، وهم القوة الدافعة والمحركة من أجل تحقيق أهدافها ومن أجل نهضتها ومن أجل حمايتها والدفاع عنها. فإن صلح شباب أمة من الأمم صلح حالها، وإن فسد جيل الشباب في الأمة فسد حال الأمة كلها، وخصوصا أمة الإسلام، لأن أمة الإسلام أمة شابة في معظم بلاد المسلمين، تكون فئة الشباب أي من هم في سن 15 مثلا إلى 30 تقرب من نصف السكان، وربما كانت في بعض البلاد أكثر من ذلك. فهم إضافة إلى أهميتهم المعنوية كونهم الطاقة المحركة في الأمة، فهم أيضا الكثرة العددية في كثير من بلاد الإسلام. My dear brothers and sisters, in Surah Al-Kahf that we are recommended to read on Friday, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the people of the cave, those few believers who left their people and went to a cave in order to seek shelter from the torture and the imprisonment of their people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first description that He gave them in the Quran is that they were young. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ نَبَأَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ We tell you their true story. إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ That's the first description. They were young. They were youth. They were not older people, as people now say, old and wise. They were young and foolish, according to the standards of the people. And that was the case with the followers of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Those who responded favorably to the call of the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam to Tawheed and to Islam and Iman in the beginning were young people. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was considered their shaykh, their elder, and he was only 42. Hamza was 28. رضي الله عنه. عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه was 26 when he became Muslim. And the rest were 20 or less than 20 years old. That is why it is very important to focus on the young people. And that is why the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام used to pay a lot of attention to the youth and to the young people. Because they are the ones who have the energy. They are the ones who have the motivation and the ability and the talents to take this ummah to a higher standard and to a higher level. Especially in an ummah like our Islamic ummah, where in many Muslim countries, those who are at a young age from 15, let's say, to 30, in many countries are 50% of the population. In some they are 2/3 of the population. We are a young ummah, and that is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is not a problem, and it should not be seen as a problem, but rather it is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In many Christian nations, most of the population is senior citizens, because they do not produce children, or they produce very little, and their population is decreasing in number. The Muslim population, alhamdulillah, is increasing, and that is because Islam encourages us to marry and encourages us to have families and encourages us to produce babies. تَنَاكَهُ تَكَاثَرُ فَإِنِّي مُبَاهِمْ بِكُمُ الْأُمَمَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ In a case like ours, it is very important to look at the young people among us and to tackle their problems and to see what their needs are and to try to respond to these needs. And especially for Muslims who live as minorities in the West, like us in this country here. Lately there has been a meeting of the imams in South Florida, and we discussed what is the single most important issue, or issues in general, that face our communities. And the number one issue was our youth, and what to do with our youth. Because if we fail to pass Islam to the coming generation, there will be no more Islam. After them, they will fail, of course, to pass Islam to others because they do not have it. And this is a serious problem. If you go to the masajid for Jum'ah, like our masjid and others, and you look around, you find that the young people, even though they are the majority in numbers, they are in the minority. Those who frequent masajid. Our prayers are no exception. It is very important then, brothers and sisters, to make sure that our young people carry the banner of Islam after us. ولهذا يا عباد الله كان من الضروري معرفة ما يواجهه هؤلاء ومساعدتهم على حل مشاكلهم وعلى مواجهة الأخطار التي تكتنفهم، لأن هناك ذئاب من حولهم من كل النواحي تريد أن تبعدهم عن دينهم وأن تبعدهم عن أمتهم وأن تجعل لهم أهدافاً أخرى لا علاقة لها بالإسلام، وأن تجعل لهم سلوكاً آخر مغايراً لما يأمر به الإسلام. فلا بد من الانتباه، ولا بد من إعماد الفكر، ولا بد من مناقشة أمورهم، ولا بد من الوصول إلى حلول، ولا بد من وضع الخطط من أجل مواجهة هذه الأخطار. وهذه الأخطار إخوة الإسلام يمكن تقسيمها إلى ثلاثة مجموعات تواجه شبابنا في مثل هذه البلاد. المجموعة الأولى من المشاكل هي مشاكل حضارية، مشكلة الانتماء ومشكلة الهوية، وهذه وإن كانت تنطبق حتى على الكبار من المسلمين، فكثير منا لا يعرف انتماءه بالضبط، هل هو مسلم أولاً، هل هو أمريكي أولاً، هل هو عربي أو إيراني أو تركي أو غير ذلك. لكنها في حالة أبنائنا تكون أكثر حدة وتكون أكثر شدة. المجموعة الثانية من الأخطار هي مجموعة الأخطار العقائدية، لأن هناك دعاة على أبواب جهنم كثر هذه الأيام يروجون لعقائدهم، ومع انفتاح الشباب على عالم التواصل الاجتماعي والإنترنت والفضائيات وغيرها صاروا معرضين إلى أن يتأثروا بمثل هذه الدعوات التي كثير منها دعوات باطلة ودعوات تدعوهم إما إلى اعتقاد غير اعتقاد الإسلام أو تدعوهم إلى بدع عقائدية ربما أخرجتهم من دين الإسلام دون أن يعرف. والمجموعة الثالثة من الأخطار هي الأخطار السلوكية، الأخطار التي تكتنفهم من حيث العادات والأعمال والسلوك الذي يسلكونه، مثل الأخطار المخدرات والمسكرات والعلاقات المحرمة والشذوذ الجنسي وسوء الأخلاق والعصابات وغيرها من الأخطار التي تهددهم فيما يتعلق بسلوكهم. هذه المجموعات الثلاث على كل واحد منا حتى وإن لم يكن له أبناء، فما بالك إن كان عنده أبناء وكانوا في مثل هذا السن، فإن أهملهم ولم ينتبه لهم وترك الأمور على غاربها دون أن يتخذ من الأعمال ومن الاحتياطات ما يمنع دون ضياعهم، فعلى الأرجح أن أبناءه سيصيبهم خطر من هذه الأخطار الثلاثة إن لم يكن كلها. في بعض الأحيان يصاب الشاب الصغير بهذه الأخطار كلها نتيجة إهمال الوالدين، مع أنهما هما المسؤولان في البداية وأساسا عن تربية أبنائهم وعن تنشئتهم التنشئة الصحيحة وعلى غرس الإسلام في نفوسهم. The kinds of dangers, brothers and sisters, and problems that our youth faces, especially in a situation like the one we are in this country here, where we are a minority, few in numbers, living in a majority, among Muslim majority, can be divided into three categories. The first category has to do with identity and culture. What is the identity of our youth? How do they see themselves? Who do they affiliate and associate themselves with? What comes first when it comes to their identity, their nationality or their creed? This is the first class or the first group of threats and dangers that our youth faces. The second group, the second class of our, of the dangers that our youth faces is that of aqeedah, their faith, their convictions, and their iman. And this problem became more pressing nowadays with the ease of access to internet and to information from all over the world. Nowadays, a 12-year-old, a 13-year-old boy or girl can get into the internet and speak with somebody in Japan or in India or in South Africa or anywhere. He can join chat groups that discuss atheism or Christianity or Baha'ism or any faith or any creed. If that 12-year-old or 13-year-old is not taken care of, if he does not have the Tawheed and the Iman of Islam in his or in her mind, most likely they will be affected. And most likely they will grow up later to express a different identity and a different creed other than the creed of Islam. It is the responsibility of their parents, first and foremost, to make sure that their children have the Islamic aqeedah in their minds and in their hearts before they let them on into the internet and into the outside world without having any knowledge. The third class or the first group of dangers that faces our youth are behavioral dangers. Dangers that have to do with their behavior. Drugs, crime, alcoholism, gambling, homosexuality, illegal relationships between men and women outside marriage, gangs, and all of these problems that are associated with behavior as well. It is very important, brothers and sisters, especially for those who have children, and those who have children in this age, from the age of 12 until, let's say, 16 or 17 or 18, to make sure that they are aware of these dangers. Do not take it for granted that you should let your child grow in this environment naturally without you interfering in their lives or without you raising them. There's a difference between a child who was raised up and a child who grew up. A child who grew up just like wild plants out there. They grow up without any trimming, without any fertilizing, without any care. We're not supposed to be like that. We are supposed to raise our children up, which means you're supposed to have a plan for them, a plan that has to do with their spirituality, a plan that has to do with their morals, a plan that has to do with their education, a plan that has to do with their aqeedah, a plan that has to do with their behavior. As a parent, or as parents, father and mother should sit down and discuss their children. If they see any problem with them, they're supposed to address it. And even before there is a problem, when they're aware of a problem, they're supposed to prevent it, to make sure that they give them the right environment and the right information from the beginning, and to warn them of these dangers before they unleash them to the world, to face that world alone, without or void of any knowledge or any understanding. But alhamdulillah, there are solutions. And I think that it's still not too late for us to respond to these challenges in a situation like ours. Even though we are losing thousands of our youth, by the way. We are losing them to atheism, we are losing them to carelessness, we are losing them to fisk, to fujur, to alcoholism, to drugs. But still, I think we have a chance of at least limiting our losses. At least saving those that we can still save. Refurbishing something before this generation of immigrants and Muslims, first Muslims, disappears and there is a second generation that does not know anything about Islam or knows very little about Islam, which will be a very serious problem and a very heavy responsibility that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask us about on the Day of Judgment. How can we deal with these problems? When it comes to identity and affiliation, in order to have the right affiliation, and in order to have the right identity, we are supposed to have an Islamic culture. And an Islamic culture means awareness of history, and awareness of our ummah, and awareness of the goals of our ummah, and awareness of the historic heroes in our ummah, and awareness of our poetry, of our language of Islam, the Arabic language, and knowledge of that. And unfortunately, some people out of ignorance think that language is not an important thing. Some people ask me, why do you speak in Arabic? Since everybody speaks English. Why don't you just speak in English all the time? They do not understand that. Arabic is part of Islam. If we lose it, we lose a very dear part of Islam, there'll be nobody who will understand the Quran. You'll be reading the Quran to people who do not know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to them. It is very important to learn Arabic if you don't know it. To encourage it if you can't. Because by preserving Arabic language, we are preserving the understanding of the Quran. We are preserving the understanding of our heritage of tens, if not hundreds of thousands of books that were written. Most of them were written by non-Arabs, but in Arabic language. Most of the books that the Islamic library has were written by Persians, or by Turks, or by Africans, but they were written in the Arabic language until the 4th century, Hijri century. Everybody was writing and reading in the Arabic language if they want to study. It was the language of knowledge among all of the Muslims. In addition to it, some spoke Kurdish, some spoke Persian, some spoke. But if they wanted to learn or they wanted to write, they used to do it in the Arabic language. Unfortunately here, the coming generation, very few among them, even though both parents are Arabs, and both of them are supposed to speak Arabic, and to encourage their children to speak Arabic, they are proud if their children do not speak Arabic. And they call that assimilation. If you lose your language, you lose half your religion, especially the Arabic language. You lose your identity. If you don't have a history, if you don't have a past, you will never have a future. If your children do not know who Arslan was and who Qutuz was and who Sufyan al-Thawri was and who Abd al-Rahman al-Dakhil was, don't expect them to have an Islamic future. You're supposed to have roots and you're supposed to be aware of who your ancestors were. What was the history of your ummah? What are the important events that happened to the Muslim ummah? And before all of that, you are supposed to know that there is something called a Muslim ummah, that it does exist. Even though politically on the map, there is no such a thing. There are countries that have Muslim majorities or Muslim minorities, but an ummah on the map does not exist. But at least at the ideological level, at the feeling level, we should know that there is 1.5, 1.6 billion people who declare that La ilaha illallah and Muhammad Rasulullah. And they share the same belief, and they share the same behavior, and they have the same preferences exactly like we do, and they have the same goals, or they're supposed to, and they aspire for the same ends like we aspire to. An ummah that does not have goals for itself is not an ummah. And this is a serious problem. In the 50s and 60s, there were ummah goals. Even though those who were not Islamists, they were not calling for Islam, they were aware that there is an ummah. So they were talking about national goals, for example, uniting all the Turkish peoples in one ummah, or uniting all the Arabs in one ummah. They were talking about liberation from occupation and from imperial powers, France and Britain. They had goals at that time, and they were aware of it. Unfortunately, nowadays, in the minds of many of the members of our ummah, there are no goals. They do not know what they want as an ummah. They do not know what they want as a group. And that contributes heavily to the loss of identity as well. You should tell your child about the history, the seerah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. That way you are giving him an identity. What is the point of believing in a prophet that you do not know anything about him? You do not know his life. You do not know what he did. You do not know who he was, just to say Muhammad Rasulullah and that's it. What kind of identity you will have when you don't know anything about the best generation that was raised up at the hands of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, the generation of the Sahaba, Abu Bakr and Ali and Uthman and Umar and Abu Ubaidah and Khalid and these people. If your child doesn't know these people, how can he assimilate and affiliate himself with them and with the Muslim ummah?
If they do not know what has happened to Muslims and how this Islamic Ummah was founded and established, they do not know about the Mongols and how they attacked. They do not know about the victories of Islam, how Constantinople was opened for Islam. They do not know about the history of Muslims in Spain. They do not know about the contributions of Islam and Muslims to science and knowledge. They don't know anything. How can they claim then that they are Muslims and they affiliate themselves with Islam? To face the problem of identity, we need to have an Islamic culture. We need to have awareness of our Islamic history, of our Islamic characters. Nowadays, if you ask most of the Muslim youth about a football player, 90% would know his name and who he is, or a singer. But if you ask them about a Muslim hero that has contributed a lot to this ummah, they will not know anything about him. You cannot expect such people to carry the banner of Islam for the next generation and to identify themselves as Muslims. And our identity as Muslim does not cancel our other identities. You belong to a certain nation, that's fine. Allah says, وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ. We made you into tribes and nations. But that should be for the purpose of knowing one another. Not to be arrogant or to think that you are better than other nations or other people. This is the first group of problems that face our youth. And this is how we face it. We face it through reviving the Islamic culture. And like I said, unfortunately for us, we do not have here except ourselves. There is no ministry of culture here that will teach you the Islamic culture or the Islamic history. You are supposed to be the ministry of culture in your home. And you are the one who's supposed to have the resources in your house to go back and read for your children about important battles that happened, about important campaigns against the Ummah and how the Muslims faced them, about failures and successes of Islam and Muslims throughout history. And if you do not do that, you are not building an identity for your Muslim. Even when you name your child an Islamic name, that has, you name him after a Muslim Sahaba, or a Muslim hero, or a Muslim scholar, you are reviving that. Instead of calling your son Danny, or calling your son Sammy, or a name that does not have any significance, choose a name that has cultural significance. That when somebody, another Muslim will hear it, at least he will ask, what does your name mean? Who was this person that you named yourself out? That's why you're encouraging the spread of the Islamic culture. إخوة الإسلام هذه هي المجموعة الأولى من المخاطر التي تواجه أبناءنا بل تواجهنا نحن حتى الكبار والله هناك صار خطر عليه كثير منهم لا يعرف تاريخه ولا يعرف حضارته وكثير منا من يبتعد حتى عن المسلمين ويظن أن في البعد عنهم السلام ليس فقط لا ينتمي للإسلام ولكن يحاول الابتعاد حتى ماديا الابتعاد عن المسلمين حتى لا يحتك بهم مثل هذا بموته انتهى الإسلام في بيته وفي وبنسبته لا يترك أثر في خدمة هذا الدين ولا يترك شيء اللهم إلا قبرا كتب عليه اسمه ربما زاره أحد وقال أن هناك كان في هذه البلاد مسلم كما يحصل للأسف في كثير من البلاد التي ذهب إليها المسلمون ونسوا هذا الأمر فذهبوا وانقرضوا مع أنهم كانوا يعدون مئات الألوف إن لم يكن بالملايين خصوصا في جنوب أمريكا في البرازيل وفي الأرجنتين وغيرها من البلاد فاتقوا الله عباد الله واحرصوا على أبنائكم وعلى أنفسكم لا تفقدوا هويتكم تمسكوا بها واعلموا أن الولاء والبراء من عقيدة الإسلام أن توالي المسلمين المؤمنين وأن تتبرأ من الشرك والمشركين هذا جزء من عقيدتك من لا يفعل ذلك ويجد أن المشركين أقرب لقلبه وأقرب له ويوادهم ويحاول أن يقلدهم وأن يكون منهم أكثر من المسلمين هذا في عقيدته شك إن كان مسلما أو غير مسلم يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى لا تجد قوما يؤمنون بالله واليوم